Good morning to all the viewers. In today's session, we are going to focus on scrutiny assessment and best judgment assessment. So before beginning my discussion, let us first focus on certain basics of assessment procedure. Generally, auditing begins where accounting ends. In the same way, assessment procedure begins after filing return of income. Whenever SSE files his return of income, then the procedure of assessment begins. What is the procedure and what are the different types of notices, time limit for issuing the notice, time limit for completing the assessment, and what are the special cases to be dealt between the period of notice and period of assessment? Those are all the things today we are going to have a discussion. So first let me present out the overview of assessment procedure first. Sir, in case of overview regarding assessment procedure, in any case, the action begins with self-assessment only. In every circumstance, SSE is going to make himself self-assessment and pay self-assessment tax under section 140A. And after making self-assessment, he is going to file his return of income under section 139 subsection 1. Sir, as it is, before entering into scrutiny assessment, first, let us learn certain basics so that the time limits and notices can be easily understood by us. So here, first SSE files the return of income under section 139 subsection 1 within the due date of filing return of income. Okay. And after due date of filing return of income, SSE shall also have time to file the return before the end of the relevant assessment year, which is called as belated return under section 139 subsection 4. And if original return filed by the SSE consists of any error or omissions, in such a case he can revise the return under section 139 subsection 5. Like this, first SSE is going to file his return of income, and if return of income is not furnished by the SSE, then AO shall issue notice under section 142 subsection 1 seeking reasons for non-filing of your return of income. So based on that, now SSE is going to file return of income. So if SSE files return of income under section 139(1), 4 or 5, or if SSE does not file his return of income, AO is going to issue notice under section 142 subsection 1. So based on this also, SSE can file the return. Finally, the thing that was happened as of now is filing of return of income. Up to now, what we have discussed here is filing of return of income has been completed. And after filing the return of income, every return filed by the SSEs, every return filed will get processed. This is not based on any risk-based criteria. Here, every return filed will get processed by CPC under section 143 subsection 1, and an intimation will be issued. So what are the things that to be considered while issuing intimation under section 143 subsection 1? There are 6 income adjustments and recomputation of tax liability. In intimation to be issued under section 143 subsection 1, CPC is going to consider 6 income adjustments. What are those 6 income adjustments? We shall discuss today only at some point of time later. And next up, coming to this, first return of income, first self-assessment, and then return of income is filed by the SC, and every return file will get processed, and then notice will be issued. After process, this notice is not for all the SSC. Based on risk analysis, risk based, certain cases will be selected for scrutiny. Scrutiny notice under section 143 subsection 2. Notice shall be issued under section 143 subsection 2, and assessment order will be issued under section 143 subsection 3. So try to remember these, generally these sections were very useful in practice. So section 143 subsection 2 is the notice, and 143 subsection 3 is the assessment order. So now we need to learn what is the mode of communication of notice, okay, and then what is the time limit for completion of assessment. And recently, now practically, e-assessment is being continued. We shall also have a complete discussion on e-assessment procedure regarding issuance of penalty orders also. complete e-assessment procedure also I have presented in step-by-step analysis. That e-assessment process also we are going to learn it today only. So e-assessment is one of the mode of assessment. E-assessment is not a new form of assessment. Like scrutiny assessment, income escaping assessment, e-assessment is not a new form of assessment. It is a new mode of assessment. This income escaping scrutiny assessment will only be done in a different way. So how they are going to assess it? So without any physical without any manual, we need not present physically in front of the assessing officer. Instead of that, how to communicate online, through online, whether any video conference facility is available. So like that, all those situations we are going to have a discussion today in e-assessment procedure. Okay, now beginning with our basics. First, notice will be issued under section 143 subsection 2, and assessment order will be issued under section 143 subsection 3. First, let us know the types of assessment. What are the types of assessment that were available? Okay, and if scrutiny time limit is completed but there is a income which has escaped the assessment, for example, if a assessee has a income taxable under the head capital gain but he has not disclosed in the return of income and neither in books of accounts also he has not disclosed the sale of his capital asset jewelry which has been sold for certain amount of cash, it has not been recorded in the books of account. At later point of view, assessing officer comes to know that he has sold such capital asset, then the scrutiny time limit has been completed. After completion of scrutiny time limit, still if assessing officer has reason to believe, the thing to be noticed here is reason to believe. What do you mean by the term reason to believe? Whether they have to be recorded in writing, everything we will discuss in tomorrow's session, income escaping assessment. Tomorrow's session, income escaping and such assessment, we shall discuss it in detail. So today, coming to section 148, that means notice, income escaping assessment notice. If scrutiny time limit is completed, and assessing officer have reason to believe that certain incomes have escaped the assessment, then he shall issue notice under section 148. And this 132 is regarding notice for stretch assessment. 132 is notice for conduct of stretch. 153A is stretch assessment order. Sir, notice section is different from assessment order section. So scrutiny notice will be issued under section 143 subsection 2. Scrutiny order shall be passed under section 143 subsection 3. Income escaping assessment notice will be issued under section 148. Income escaping assessment order shall be passed under section 147. Stretch notice for conducting stretch, that means stretch warrant, shall be executed under section 132. Stretch assessment order shall be passed under section 153A. Okay. In continuation of my discussion, this is the notice and this is the assessment order. So I think the bifurcation between them is clear. And after passing assessment order, if there are mistakes in the assessment order or disputable matter. Sir, what do you mean by the term mistake and dispute? Mistake actually means it was apparent on the face of the record. That means total calculation there is a mistake, or instead of disallowance, assessing officer have allowed the expenditure but it was communicated in the notice that this shall be disallowed, but actually it has been allowed as an expenditure. That means there is a mistake apparent on the face of record, and mistake should be accepted both by the assessee and also by assessing officer. In such a case, this mistake assessing officer is going to get it rectified under section 154. After passing assessment order, if there are any mistakes in the assessment order, they shall get rectified under section 154. This 154 rectification right is the assessing officer. SSE is going to request the assessing officer to rectify, or before request by the SSE, suo moto, assessing officer can suo moto can rectify based on section 154, or based on application of SSE also it can get rectified. And coming to dispute, sir, what is the difference between mistake and dispute? SSE is specifying that expenditure is allowable. Assessing officer is specifying that no, this expenditure must be disallowed. Now this is not the mistake, this is the dispute. Mistakes means both has to agree and the order can be rectified. But in case of dispute between the SSC and assessing officer, this has to be dealt either by way of appeal or revision. SSC has two alternatives. Sir, after passing this assessment order, first we have begin with self-assessment. And after passing this assessment order, rectification of return of income has been filed. It has been processed. Some returns have been selected for scrutiny, income escaping or stretch, whatever may be based upon the situation. And after passing of assessment order, any of assessment order has been passed. And if there are any mistakes, then it can get rectified under section 154. But second part coming here, if there is any dispute between the SSC and assessing officer, in such a case, if you refer first part, SSC can either go for appeal or revision. If SSC goes for appeal, first appeal to CIT appeals. First appeal has to be made to Commission of Income Tax. Jurisdictional Commission of Income Tax appeals has to be applied under section 246 subsection A. So, if SSC has lost the case at CIT appeals, then he can go for next appeal to ITAT. He can go for next appeal to ITAT under section 253, second appeal. And still if SSC loses and the case is of question of law, then SSC can approach High Court under section 260A. And still SSC has lost the case, then he can approach Supreme Court under section 262. So like this, the things that were specified here is the appeal procedure beginning from CIT appeals, next appeal to ITAT, next appeal to High Court, next appeal to Supreme Court, and judgment passed by Supreme Court is final. So if there is any dispute, SSC can go for either appeal or second part coming into revision. The second option available to SSC is, instead of approaching Commissioner of Income Tax appeals, SSC can approach Commissioner of Income Tax to revise the order passed by the subordinate authorities. Your subordinate authority's order is being aggrieved by the SSC. That means he is not satisfactory with the assessment order passed by the officer. In such a case, since a dispute arises, instead of going to the appeal, he may also approach to CIT for revision. Actually, in case of CIT appeal, 60 days, ITAT, 30 days CIT appeals, ITAT appeals, 60 days. High Court, we have to approach within 120 days. And Supreme Court, we have to approach within 90 days. This is the time limit for application of appeal. But in case of revision, after passing assessment order, within 1 year, at any time, SSC can approach Commission of Income Tax to get the order revised. But the thing to be noticed here is, this order passed by CIT is final and conclusive. He cannot approach back again to appeals. Initially only, SSC has to decide whether to go to appeal or revision. He has to decide at initial level itself. So based on that, if SSC goes for appeal, then he have other alternatives, CIT appeals, ITAT, High Court and Supreme Court. But coming to second part, if SSC goes for revision, then the revision order passed by CIT is final and conclusive. He cannot come back to appeal again. Okay. Appeal may be as per other constitutions, but based on Income Tax Act, again, they cannot approach for appeal is the conclusion. So like this, these are the various options available to the SSC. Okay. So we have begin with the self-assessment. From self-assessment onwards, up to the Supreme Court cases. So generally, what is the assessment procedure to be followed? I have made a presentation here. And now, let us begin our discussion with scrutiny assessment. But before commencing scrutiny assessment, before scrutiny, first return shall be processed by the CPC. First, let us have a small discussion for 5 minutes. Let us have a discussion regarding processing of returns and issuing intimation under section 143 subsection 1. So first, initially, let us have a discussion on processing of returns, and later we can focus immediately on scrutiny notice and its assessment. So first, coming to processing of returns, I have specified you that in processing of returns, there will be 6 income adjustment, and then tax liability shall be recomputed based upon such income adjustments. So now let us focus on what are the 6 income adjustments that were available. Point number 1, any arithmetical errors in the return will get rectified while issuing intimation. and any incorrect claim apparent from any information in the return. For example, in case SSC is going to claim deduction under section 80G, then he has to compulsorily quote the PAN of such trust to any other person you are going to donate. The person to whom you have donated, you have to specify the PAN of such a person. If such PAN has been wrongly quoted, CPC is going to verify such PAN with the records available with the income tax department, online facility only. If 80G registration does not exist for this PAN, then such deduction claimed by SSC under section 80G shall be denied. That means it shall not be claimed as reduction. Now SSC is liable to pay the taxes. Like this, any incorrect claims have been made shall be rectified here. And along with that, disallowance of losses claimed if the return of the income for which loss was claimed beyond the due date specified under section 139 subsection 1. Beyond the due date under section 139 subsection 1, that means if SSC has filed belated return, except loss from house property and unabsorbed depreciation, except these two items, no other thing can be carry forwarded. Except unabsorbed depreciation and income from house property, these two losses can be carry forwarded even though belated return has been claimed. But other losses can be carry forwarded only if the return of income has been filed within the due date. If SSC has filed belated return, then next year he cannot set off such losses. If SSC set off such losses in his return of income, then what the CPC is going to do is disallowance of such losses. These things need not be done by the assessing officer manually. These things will be done by CPC in electronic mode only. Next, coming to other thing, the things which were quoted in audit report 3CB, 3CD, if you have specified any disallowance to be made, which SSC has not disclosed in his written of income, and we have reported it in audit report in 3CB, 3CD, such items shall also be disallowed. Such items will also be adjusted while computing income by CPC. Any expenditure, any disallowance which was indicated in audit report shall also be adjusted is the criteria. And next, 10AA, SEDGE exemption, and section 80IA to RRB. These deductions can be claimed only if the return is filed within the due date. If return has been filed belatedly, generally these deductions cannot be claimed. If return has been filed belatedly, these deductions under section 10AA, 80IA to RRB generally cannot be claimed by the SSC. So, if SSC have claimed many of the people in case of filing cooperative society returns, deduction under section 80P might have claimed even though the return of income has been filed belatedly. Even though return of income has been filed belatedly, if you have filed deduction under section 80P, now the thing that is going to do is disallowance of such deduction. Such deduction cannot be claimed. So this profit link deductions, not all chapter 6A deductions were covered here. Not all the sections from 80C to 80U, from 80IA to 80RRB, those deductions shall be disallowed is the conclusion. If return has been filed belatedly and if SSC has claimed deduction, then they shall be disallowed is the conclusion. Next, coming to other thing, addition of income appearing in form number 26A is very, very important aspect. Addition of income appearing in form number 26AS. Sir, what do you mean by the term here, form 26AS? When any TDS has been deducted, that has to be reported by the SSC in his written of income. Now, from past assessment year onwards, at the time of filing written of income, when we are going to import the 26AS into our return filing software, then the software is going to ask under which head of income you have offered that income and its TDS. If any TDS has been deducted under 194H commission, now we need to report under which head of income we have reported such income. Whether I have shown such commission under head PGBP or under head other sources, we have to compulsorily show it. If SSC has not disclosed certain items which were presented in 26AS, in such a case, now what CPC is going to do is, it is going to add such income. For example, in one client case, the thing they have done is interest where TDS has been deducted under 194A, okay, it has to be shown under the head income from other sources. If it is a business interest, okay, PGBP. generally we are going to offer it under head income from other sources. In other sources we have to select it as interest item, but by mistake they have selected it as a rent item. Now after filing return of income, CPC has verified that under section 194A TDS has been deducted and you have shown it under the head income from other sources. But in other sources if you refer, instead of showing it as interest item, he has shown it as rent item. So what the CPC is going to do now is again add the interest income which was specified in form 26A's, because you have not disclosed such income in your return of income. All the items which were presented in form 26A's has to be compulsorily disclosed, okay, except one item, that is regarding cash withdrawals. Recently the government has constituted section 194N regarding cash withdrawals. When any cash withdrawals from your bank account exceeds 1 crore, then they are going to deduct TDS at the rate 2%. So this cash withdrawal is not the income of the SSE, is an exception. Except this section, all other sections the TDS deduction made and reflected in 26AS has to be recognized as income of the SSE. If you are not going to show it as income in such a case, what the CPC is going to do is add such items which were appearing in 26AS. Like this, 6 items shall be adjusted towards the total income. Now in continuation of my discussion, along after computing such income, after addition of such incomes, tax liability shall also be recomputed. So based on that, before addition of such income, in my previous example, if you remember, instead of showing it as interest item, by mistake we have disclosed it as rent item. And now tax liability arises because 26 CPC doesn't know that by mistake you have offered it as a rent item. For that purpose, what CPC is going to do now is intimate before the adjustment. Before making adjustment, first CPC is going to intimate. Before issuance of intimation under 143(1), first they are going to make prima facie adjustment. If you refer, this is in income tax website. In this e-proceeding column, we have e-assessment proceedings. There, prima facie adjustment. This response has to be given by the SSE within 30 days. So CPC, before issuing intimation and demand order, first gives an intimation before the adjustment. Such adjustment SSE should get rectified within 30 days if there is a mistake. If still SSE does not rectify it, then in such a case CPC shall determine the tax payable under section 143 subsection 1. An intimation will be prepared and generated based on the above. Based on this, an intimation shall be generated. So based on that, the difference of tax payable will be presented here. For the difference of tax payable, if some payable exists, demand notice shall be issued under section 156. If refund is due, refund will be sanctioned. If it is a loss return, so balance loss, how much to be carried forwarded shall be reflected. And if everything is correct, no sum payable or no sum is refundable, then also intimation will be given. All the returns filed shall be processed, is the conclusion that we are going to arrive here. Next, within what is the time limit for issuing intimation? No intimation shall be issued after the expiry of 1 year. That means intimation has to be issued before expiry of 1 year from the end of the year in which return is made. 1 year from the end of the year in which return is made. Okay. So, for example, if return of income for assessment year 18-19, or let us take assessment year 19-20, is filed on 20th March 2020, then in such case from the end of such relevant assessment year, so the return has been filed on 20th March 2020, in such case from 20th March 2020 year ending means 31st March 2020, from such year ending 1 year has been specified here. So 2020 from this year ending 31st March 2020. So 1 year has been specified. That means by 31st March 2021, intimation should be issued is the conclusion. Okay. Now all these intimations shall be issued by CPC, Centralized Processing Scheme. No person shall be required to appear. So, but if any reason CPC could not process the return, then it shall be transferred to the assessing officer. When it was transferred to assessing officer, when you go for view returns, like this, you will have ITR transferred out of CPC to jurisdictional assessing officer. If you go for e-returns, view e-filed returns, there if you click on view returns, here like this, it will be displayed, ITRV, XML, ITR form. Here, instead of issuing intimation, the thing that will be specified here is ITR was transferred to jurisdiction officer. Now, jurisdiction officer issues intimation. Okay. And next, mandatory processing of return. I have already specified you, every return file should get mandatorily processed is the conclusion. Okay. Now we are entering into, as of now, we have discussed basics. So, based on self-assessment, we have completed filing of return of income. And then we have entered for next thing regarding intimation under section 143 subsection 1. And after that, now we are going to the complete discussion. We are going to discuss complete thing practically. So let us begin our discussion. Scrutiny assessment or regular assessment. Scrutiny assessment or regular assessment. Now let us have a discussion regarding this. So here, the thing that was specified here is scrutiny assessment. Before beginning of scrutiny assessment, issuance of notice under section 143 subsection 2. So the first thing that was specified here is scrutiny of notice under section 143 subsection 2. Sir, all the returns filed will not get scrutinized. Based on risk base, the department is going to select some cases for scrutiny, and after selection of the scrutiny, first, a notice shall be issued under section 143 subsection 2, and then assessment order shall be issued under 143 subsection 3. So now let us discuss the time limits, issuance of notice. Now let us have a discussion. The first thing that was specified here is issuance of notice under section 143 subsection 2. When assessing officer issues notice under section 143 subsection 2, the return filed by the SSE either under 139 or 142 subsection 1, AO considers it necessary or expedient to ensure that the income has not been understated. Income has not been understated. And income has not been computed, SSE have not computed excessive loss. And SSE has not underpaid the tax. So if this is a situation, if SSE has not to ensure that SSE has not understated the income, that means if there is a doubt that SSE has understated the income and SSE have computed excessive loss and SSE has underpaid the tax, sir, here reason to believe is not required for scrutiny. In for scrutiny, any return filed by the SSE can be selected for scrutiny. Here reason to believe is not the criteria. Assessing officer need not know complete facts. That was regarding income escaping and stretch assessment, where reason to believe is required. But here, reason to believe is not the criteria. So first thing, situation, return has to be filed. Okay. And if there is any understatement, now assessing officer is going to verify whether there is any understatement of income, whether he has computed excessive loss, or whether he has spent underpayment of taxes. Like that, they are going to verify the situation. In this situation, notice shall be issued by the assessing officer. Sir, now two schemes, regular general scheme and new e-assessment scheme. In general scheme, assessing officer is going to issue notice to attend his office and produce the evidence on which SSE may rely in support of the return. So the thing that they are going to do here is assessing officer may serve the notice. Sir, if you notice here, serve, not issuance of notice. It has to be received by the SSE. Notice has to be served within the due date. So issuance within the due date is not the criteria. It should be served through the SSE. What are the modes of serving notice? Let us have a discussion. Sir, here in e-assessment procedure, this notice shall be issued online. And earlier, they used to issue notice to attend his office. But since now, everything is under e-assessment. Rather than issuing notice to attend his office, now what the thing that was required to do, let us have a discussion. Before that, let me first concentrate on serve of a notice. What is the time limit for serving the notice? No notice shall be served after the expiry of 6 months from the end of the financial year in which return is filed. Sir, if you notice the thing that was presented here, no notice shall be served after the expiry of 6 months. That means the notice, scrutiny notice has to be issued before the end of 6 months from the end of the year in which return is filed. So, in this example only, if return relating to assessment year 1920 has been filed on 30th March 2020, okay, so 20th March 2020. Then within which time period this scrutiny notice shall be issued? From the end of this assessment year, that means from the end of this year in which return is filed, 30th March 2020. From this date, within 6 months, from this date, within 6 months, that means 30th September 2020. So for the returns which we are going to file by 30th March 2020 in past March month, scrutiny notice shall be received within 30th September 2020 is the conclusion that we are going to derive here. So scrutiny notice should be, the thing that was specified here is scrutiny notice should be served within 6 months from the end of the financial year in which return is filed is the conclusion. So I think this provision is very clear. So now in continuation of my discussion, if assessee do not respond to such scrutiny notice, in such a case, penalty shall be levied to the extent of 10,000 per default. And along this with penalty, assessment will not get closed. If assessee attends, now assessment shall be done based on the requirements produced by the assessee. But if assessee does not attend to such scrutiny assessment, in such a case, assessing officer is going to do best judgment assessment. That thing also we are going to discuss in today's session only. So, failure to comply with notice under section 143 subsection 2 shall attract a penalty of 10,000 per default is the thing that was specified. Plus, another thing that was specified here is to make best judgment assessment if assessee do not respond to the notice. Okay. Now, these four aspects, now we need to discuss in present mode. So, based on requirements submitted by the assessee, regular assessment shall be made. On this basis, AO shall make an assessment and determine the sum payable. This is a very, very simple aspect. So, when the assessment order has to be passed, and after discussing these time limits, I will enter for e-assessment scheme. Now, practically, very, very important aspect, sir. Now, every chartered accountant in practice has to reply through e-assessment only. So, what is the assessment procedure? This scrutiny assessment procedure only in e-environment. So, what is the procedure to be followed? Let us have a discussion. Before commencement of this discussion, let me first conclude the time limit for completion of the assessment. Sir, for assessment order under section 143, 143 means scrutiny assessment order. Now, assessment year 1920, 12 months is the time limit from the end of the relevant assessment year. From the end of the assessment year, within 12 months, this notice, this order has to be passed. And relating to assessment 1718, time limit of 21 months has been specified. And assessment year 1819, 18 months time limit has been specified. Now, assessment year 1920 and thereafter, 12 months has been specified. Now, let me give an example. Now, regarding this assessment year 1819 return filed by the assessee, from this end of the assessment year, that means 31st March 2019, okay, from here onwards, the time period of 18 months, that means 30th September 2020, by this date, now we are in May. By September 2020, all the notices which were issued regarding assessment year 1819, assessment should be completed. But due to COVID-19 situation, so last 2 days back, this time limit has been increased to 31st December 2020. So 3 months have been extended. So due to COVID-19 situation, but generally the time limit is 18 months as of now. But earlier, the thing that was specified is earlier 18 months and before assessment 17-18, 21 months has been specified. For assessment 18-19 notices, 18 months. And from next year, that means past assessment year 19-20 we have filed by this March, that notices, that assessment order shall be passed by the end of this 31st March 2021 only. The time limits were being reduced because government is going to implement the assessment in a phased manner by way of e-assessment. Since e-assessment is being introduced, so in order to complete the assessment as early as possible, this process has been constituted. So I think this provision is very clear. Now in continuation of my discussion, if any arm's length price, that means international transaction, exist. So if there is any reference made to TPO under section 92 CA to determine the arm's length price, in such a case, additional time limit of 12 months is available. An additional time limit of 12 more months will be available in this case. That means 21 becomes 33, 18 becomes 30, 12 becomes 24. 24 months time period will be given if there are any international transactions. Okay. And the next thing that was specified, if there is any revival. Sir, generally, if stretch assessment has been constituted, then past 6 years returns should be filed by the SSC. Now, extension is given for 4 more assessment years. Past 10 years should be again filed by the SSC returns. How to compute these years? Tomorrow's session, we will discuss regarding income escaping assessment and stretch assessment. There, we will get much more criteria. So now in continuation of my discussion, revival under section 153A, that means if such assessment has been constituted, pending scrutiny assessment will get abated, that means they will stop the pending assessment, because in such all the 6 years shall be again reassessed. So if there are any pending assessments, it will get stopped. But if such is cancelled, then again the scrutiny assessment which is abated will get revived. This is the meaning of revival. Much more we will discuss in tomorrow stretch assessment session. First, let me once again clarify the concept of revival. First, initially, if SSC is going to file his return of income, that is 139 section return filing. And then if scrutiny has been selected, this assessment, then along with such, if any stretch assessment proceedings were also implemented, then pending income escaping, pending scrutiny assessment will get abated. That means they will cancel the pending assessment, because those will also be covered in such assessment only. So pending assessments will abate. But if in any circumstance such is cancelled, such assessment has been annulled, in such a case, the scrutiny assessment which is abated earlier shall be revived. That means shall be reopened again now. For such reopening, the time limit is 1 year from the end of the month of such revival, or normal above this 12 months, 18 months time limit, whichever is later. So the time limit has been enhanced in case of revival is the conclusion. So I think this revival concept is also very clear. Now let me introduce the concept of e-assessment. So practically now what the thing I am going to discuss from now onwards is very, very useful for all the chartered accountants, because from assessment year 1920, for all the returns filed for the assessment year 1920, so generally the concept of e-assessment has been presented. The concept of e-assessment has been presented. So assessing officer selecting the case for scrutiny and issuing notice under 143 subsection 2 to attend his office and or through authorized representative, now such concept no more existed. Such concept existed, but very, very low percentage. Earlier, section 143 subsection 3 scrutiny order. Now 143 3A regarding this e-assessment, now we are going to have a discussion. So how to present it, what is the constitution, and how they have framed this e-assessment, let us have a discussion. Sir, before beginning with the concept of e-assessment, first you need to learn 6 technical terms. After knowing these 6 technical terms, then we can understand this concept of e-assessment procedure in a detailed manner. Sir, as of now, if you refer, You may ask any of the chartered accountant, just notice has been issued for assessment year 1920 in e-assessment scheme, and chartered accountants in representation of their clients have filed the reply to such notice. Up to that aspect only, as of now, procedure has been implemented. Further communication is not received by any SSE from any of the e-assessment, national e-assessment center. As of now, the thing they have done is issuance of notices, and then after issuance of notice, acceptance of reply from the SSE. Up to that extent only, now this e-assessment procedure has been completed. And how they are going to make the assessment, how they shall communicate to the SSE, how SSE should reply to it, and based on that, how the final order will be drafted, this procedure I am going to discuss in a detailed manner in today's session, because now the concept completely lies in e-assessment only. In e-assessment, before continuation of discussion, we need to learn six technical terms here. So what are those six technical terms? Number one, National E-Assessment Center. So for this purpose, a new constitution has been framed, which is called as National E-Assessment Center. Like income tax department, one office. So a new thing that was constituted to control this e-assessment centrally is a National E-Assessment Center. This is a central, not statewide concept. This is a central concept that has been specified. Now coming to second aspect, Regional E-Assessment Center. Sir, National E-Assessment Center and Regional E-Assessment Center. Sir, now we are going to learn a new term called E-Assessment Center. E-assessment centers are of two types. Number one, National E-Assessment, Regional E-Assessment. Sir, first thing to be noticed here is, who shall issue scrutiny notice? Scrutiny notice shall be issued under section 143 subsection 2, and scrutiny assessment shall be made under section 143 subsection 3. Now, between this gap, they have framed the concept of e-assessment. Okay. Now, what is the procedure of this e-assessment? We are going to discuss that. First, notice. Step number one, notice under section 143 subsection 2. Who is going to issue this notice under section 143 subsection 2? National E-Assessment Center, not the jurisdictional assessing officer. Now, National E-Assessment Center is going to issue notice under section 143 subsection 2. Then what about second part, Regional E-Assessment Center? Sir, Regional E-Assessment Center means, after National E-Assessment Center selects a case for scrutiny, such case shall be transferred to, that means jurisdiction shall be divided to, Regional Principal Chief Commissioner for making the assessment. Selection shall be done and notice will be issued by National E-Assessment Center, and then this assessment shall be allotted to Regional E-Assessment Center. Regional E-Assessment Center exists for each region. Based on their criteria, CBDT instructions, they are going to divide it into some regions. Based on that, each region will have Regional E-Assessment Centers, and total central wide we are going to have National E-Assessment Center. Sir, once again, I am going to clarify you that since this e-assessment is a new scheme, let us discuss in a detailed manner, which is useful for all the chartered accountants in practice. So this concept is very, very useful. The first thing here that was specified is, notice initially will be issued by the National E-Assessment Center, because now there is no representation in person. In person, now we need not attend the assessing to the office of the assessing officer, income tax office, we need not attend personally. Now every communication is through online only. Now I am discussing that online communication in a detailed manner. Now coming to second part, so I think the terms national and regional is very clear. National E-Assessment Center is only one, but regional E-Assessment Centers may be many. SSE does not know regarding this regional E-Assessment Center. SSE knows only regarding this National E-Assessment Center. Every notice will be issued by National E-Assessment Center only, but not by Regional E-Assessment Center. Okay. So let me take one thing, just for understanding sake. This is not the criteria, just for understanding sake. National E-Assessment is the employer. Okay. And Regional E-Assessment Centers were employees.
and SSE is the customer. So based on this, you can understand it in an easy manner. So in this case, the thing that was required to do is, when anything SSE needs to bargain or invoice to be issued, whether invoice will be issued by employee or employer, employer issues the invoice. Like that, in the same way, here notice shall be issued by the National E-Assessment Center. But who will show this product to the customer? Employee will show product to the customer. In the same way, assessment shall be done by Regional E-Assessment Center. But notice and order will be issued by the National E-Assessment Center. Okay. So in continuation of my discussion, so they will issue notice, okay, and then allot this case to a regional assessing officer. And then the third thing here that was specified is assessment unit. This regional e-assessment center, they have three units here: assessment unit, verification unit, technical unit. Here we have three things that were specified. So here we have three things that were specified: assessment unit, verification unit, and a technical unit. Three things were specified here. So let us discuss it in a easy manner. Sir, what do you mean by the term assessment unit? They will mention the requirements. What are the requirements we need? They shall list out. And after collection of the requirement, based on that assessment, that means whether income has been underconstituted, whether TDS has been deducted or not, whether any expenditure has been written as excessive, all this assessment procedure will be performed by this assessment unit. Okay. And after that, after completion of assessment unit requirements, for example, if any bank account is being mentioned as requirement and SSE has submitted such bank account, but assessing officer has certain doubts whether this bank account is correct one or fake one. Even the SSE has collected it from bank, still assessing officer have doubt regarding whether such bank account is real or fake. In such a case, they will allot this case to verification unit. Sir, since this is a new assessment procedure, everything will be new only. But after my discussion, everything will get automatically clarified. Assessment unit, verification unit, and technical unit. What do you mean by the term verification unit? Upon assessment by such assessment units, if any verification is required from third party, like bank statement or demat account, any confirmation from stock broker, like that, if any verification is required, they will specify this to the verification units. And then the third thing that was specified here is a technical unit. Sir, e-assessment scheme, technical unit has been specified here. What do you mean by the term technical unit? Whether any technical problem arises to assessment units at the time of drafting the order, they shall send it to the technical unit, where they will give advices regarding legal, accounting, forensic, so information technology, valuation, transfer pricing. So like this, they can get technical assistance. That means both from knowledge point of view and also from technical discrepancies. From knowledge point of view, they will give suggestions how to make the assessment. So like the technical units have also been framed here. And then review units. After this assessment unit has completed the assessment and drafted an assessment order, it shall be reviewed by the review units. So then every communication shall be made through National E-Assessment Center only. Direct, these units are not going to communicate to the SSE directly. This review unit, assessment unit, verification unit, technical unit, they are not going to communicate directly to the SSE. Every communication to the SSE shall be made through National E-Assessment Center only. If you refer section 143 subsection 3A, in order to make the assessment in an effective manner, in a transparent manner, and to avoid the physical interface with the assessing officer, this concept of e-assessment has been framed. It has been clearly constituted in section 143 subsection 3A. So based on that only, I am going to give you a conclusion that, sir, here just we have learned the terms. Just terms we have learned, and how, what is the procedure for issuance of notice, how the SSE is going to reply, that's what now I am going to discuss here. procedure in e-assessment. Sir, from assessment year 1920 onwards, generally all the scrutinies were being converted to e-assessments. Now, chartered accountant need not personally attend as an authorized representative to the assessing officer. Every communication shall be made through online only. So, what is the mode of communication? Sir, whether any physical, I mean in personal, we need to attend to the assessing officer. Answer is no. Every communication shall be made online only. Okay. So, whether any video conference facility is available. So, let me have a discussion. Before such procedure, first let me show you one thing. Communication and electronic record. Every requirement that were raised, that was raised in e-assessment, should be made exclusively by electronic mode only. There is no other option. Every communication only through electronic mode. There is no submission of documents manually to them. So everything will be through electronic mode only, and it shall be authenticated by digital signature or EVC, electronic verification code, or digital signature, whatever may be, such authentication has to be made. Okay. So now coming into our discussion, appearance before the taxpayer, before the center and units. Sir, center means nothing but employer, units means nothing but employee. Our communication should be directly to the center but not to the units. Even units directly cannot issue notice to the SSC. They have to issue through center only. So, I will discuss the procedure in a detailed manner. Before that, first let me give you a clarification that not requirement to either personally through authorized representative. There is no concept of personal hearing. But if it cannot be communicated through electronic record, in such a case, one option has been given through video conferencing, where the unit requires that, where the unit, the technical unit or assessment unit requires that, it requires communication with the SSC, then video conferencing has only been specified. So, nothing, there is no personal or representative that was specified here. So, the thing that was specified here is video conferencing. What is the mode of video conferencing shall be, has not been specified as of now. So, what is the procedure for video conferencing will be intimated to us later. So, present, there is an option. There is no option for personal attendance. There is an option for video conferencing only as of now. Okay. So, now the thing I am going to specify you is the assessment procedure. Where this notice begins, where the order ends, all these things now we are going to discuss in the balance time period. So, in continuation, a notice under section 143 would be served by the National E-Assessment Center. Sir, the thing that was used here is serving of the notice. So, what is the mode of serving of notice? Let me show you such discussion once. Yeah. So, here is the mode of serving the notice. How the notice can be served? Section 282. By post or courier. Okay. Or email to the registered email ID. This is what the thing they are doing as of now. When any mail they can send to the registered email ID, even though the SSC views such mail or does not view such mail is not the criteria. Because if you refer here, deemed service, date of posting in email shall be deemed to be the service of notice. Whenever you are going to post, you are going to send email, assessing officer is going to send the email, it shall be deemed that notice has been served. So, modes of communication of notice can be through registered email ID also is the conclusion. Or another new thing, e-filing of returns, placing a copy in a official website, in income tax e-filing website itself, when they are going to log on, then they can automatically see that e-filing of returns, e-assessment column after logging into income tax India e-filing.gov.in, if we log in based on the PAN of the SSC, there the thing that was specified here is filing of returns. There official website, you can view the notice. There in official website only we can view the notice. If it was available in the website, then it shall be deemed to be served. So, now posting by through post or courier is not the criteria. Now, this notice can be sent to our registered email ID
or it can be sent to our website also, whatever may be. Okay. And next, authentication. Generally, if they mention the name and officer designation, it shall be deemed to be authenticated, need not be signed by them. Okay. Now let me continue my discussion regarding e-assessment. Now here the thing that was given is 143(2) notice should be served. What do you mean by the term served? That's what I have discussed as of now. So a notice under 143(2) would be served by the National e-assessment procedure specifying the issues for selection of taxpayer case for assessment. So they will specify the issues why they have selected your case for e-assessment. What are the requirements that you are required to be submitted? Everything, the notice shall be issued by National e-assessment center. So this chart, so let me present it in an easy manner once again here. First, notice. Notice under section 143 subsection 2 by National e-assessment center. NEC stands for National e-assessment center. So here the notice shall be issued. And now the thing they are going to do is national, the taxpayer has a period of 15 days to file a response, but practically for assessment 1920 they have given 30 days in the scheme. So but theoretically the thing that was specified here is taxpayer should supply the response within 15 days the requirements that was asked by the, that was mentioned by the National e-assessment center. Now what e-assessment center is going to do is transfer the case to regional e-assessment center. Sir, I have already specified you the terms. Now this National e-assessment center will transfer the case to regional e-assessment center. Regional e-assessment center assessment unit, because if you remember there were various units available like assessment unit, verification unit, technical unit, review unit. There were four units which were specified by National e-assessment center. Now to whom they are going to allot this case is regional e-assessment center assessment unit. They are going to send this. Okay. So first, upon issuance of notice, the case shall be allotted to the, sir, let us discuss in a step-wise manner so that this e-assessment shall be easily understood by us. The National e-assessment center will assign case selected for the purpose of e-assessment to a specific assessment unit. First constitution is National e-assessment center. They are going to allot to the assessment unit of one regional e-assessment center through automatic allocation. Now once the assessment unit is selected, it may make request to National e-assessment center for obtaining. So that means now they will make a list of requirements. Okay, now assessment unit will make the list of requirements, and this list of requirement will be sent to National e-assessment center. Now this National e-assessment center will issue notice to the SSE to provide these requirements. That means directly assessment unit cannot issue notice to the SSE. This assessment unit is nothing but employee of National e-assessment center indirectly. Okay. So the thing I am going to give you here conclusion is assessment unit shall specify the requirements and give it to National e-assessment center. Now National e-assessment center gives notice to the SSE. Now SSE files the reply. Based on that reply, the case will be allotted to the requirement shall be sent to the assessment unit. Okay. If assessment unit requires any verification, if they requires any verification, okay, in such a case, for verification purpose, there is a unit called verification unit. Sir, what the things to be verified? Let me take an example. Number one, bank statement is to be verified. Number two, creditor's external confirmation is to be verified. Number three, unsecured loans list should be cross-examined. For this verification purpose,
what they are going to allot is VU, verification unit.
Sir, there were various units in National E-Assessment Centers. So first thing I have specified is National E-Assessment Center, through NEC only every communication should be made.
So first assessment unit will be allotted. Complete assessment will be done by this assessment unit only.
But if they require any verification, in such a case, they shall ask the verification unit to provide the requirements, to provide the confirmation regarding bank statement or creditors.
So, for the purpose of examination, if you refer here, conducting certain inquiry by verification unit.
So, now e-assessment, this assessment unit is going to specify the requirements to, these requirements will be given to National E-Assessment Center.
What are the requirements to be submitted? Accounts, expenses, income details, stock details, raw material, working progress, and if any property is being sold, declaration regarding stamp duty value. These are all the requirements that will be quoted here. Okay, these requirements list will be sent to NEC. NEC will give notice to the SSC, and if they need any verification, they will take the help of the verification unit. And if this assessment unit does not have knowledge on certain aspects, then if they need any clarification regarding certain points, then they will ask technical unit. This technical unit, what they are going to do is a share of knowledge regarding arm's length price, or regarding computation of capital gain, regarding exemptions relating, whether any doubt arises to the assessment unit, they can ask the technical unit to provide the assistance, if you refer here. So, requirements shall be collected from National Assessment Center. They can ask the help of verification unit for confirmation of the information, and they can take technical assistance from the technical unit. Generally, what does technical unit do with? Here we had a discussion regarding technical unit. They have legal, accounting, forensic, information technology. All these services shall be offered by the technical unit who has expert knowledge. Okay. Now, in continuation of my discussion, now National E-Assessment Center, they will allot verification unit and then can draft an assessment order. Now, let me give you a clarification. First, after issuing notice, SSC files the reply. Now, full information is with this assessment unit. Now, full information is available with this assessment unit. Now, what this assessment unit is required to do is pass a draft assessment order. Draft assessment order. This draft assessment order shall be sent to National E-Assessment Center. Now, National E-Assessment Center sends it to review unit. If you refer, assessment unit, verification unit, technical unit, review unit. So, this has been clearly specified how they have decentralized the structure. Decentralization is very, very perfect from CBDT point of view. Here, they have allotted review unit. After passing the draft assessment order by the assessing officer, earlier drafting shall be made by assessing officer, issuance shall also be made by the assessing officer, but now drafting shall be made by the assessment unit. Now, after assessment unit passes the draft assessment order, it shall be reviewed by the review unit. After this review unit gives any additional points, based on that again this process will be repeated. Now, this review unit will send again information to E-Assessment. E-Assessment Center will send to assessment unit. Then they again give notice to SSC. SSC will again submit reply. Then verification, technical. This chain repeats. And everything is clear. Then draft assessment order comes into final assessment order. This will be communicated to SSC under 143.3. Okay. Now, let me give much more clarification regarding this. First, sir, I have discussed all the technical terms, but for your easy clarification, a final chart now I am going to lay it out, and then next enter it for best judgment assessment of our today's session. First, notice shall be issued
under section 143 subsection 2 by National E-Assessment Center to SSE is the first point. Okay. After that, now National E-Assessment Center transfers the case to assessment unit. Okay. Now assessment unit gives requirement list. They give requirement list to NEC. That means National E-Assessment Center. National E-Assessment Center gives notice to SSE and takes the reply from them and submit to this assessment unit. Now assessment unit, if they require verification, verification means any confirmation whether bank statement is correct or not, they shall transfer the case to verification unit. The thing that was specified here is the case shall be transferred to the verification unit. What that verification unit does? Confirm that information produced by SSE is correct. They verify online or manual, whatever may be, they will do complete verification. This for the purpose of earlier assessment, verification, review, technical, everything will be dealt by assessing officer only. But now the power is decentralized. First, NEC is going to take complete control. NEC gives notice to allots the case to assessment unit. Assessment unit work is to collect the information. For the purpose of conformity, they will allot the requirements, the specifications given by SSE to verification unit. Verification unit shall verify and communicate back to the assessment unit. And if assessment unit, and if this assessment unit needs any knowledge on information technology, accounting, legal, whatever may be, every service now shall be provided by technical unit. Assessment unit, if they require any knowledge or technical problems, whatever may be, for that a technical unit has been allotted. Technical units shall suggest to the assessment unit. Based upon that, now assessment unit shall pass draft order. That means this assessment unit, in order to pass the order, they need the help of verification unit and technical unit is the conclusion. So assessment unit will issue order with the help of verification unit and technical unit. Obtaining those information, now assessment unit passes a draft order. Now based on this draft order, the thing that this draft order is communicated to NEC, National E-Assessment Center. National E-Assessment Center is going to communicate to SSE. Now SSE is going to give reply whether to accept the assessment order or whether any additional points required to get clarified. Now based on reply, this chain repeats. Okay, 1 minute. One more thing to be noted here is this draft assessment order, SSE is going to file the reply. Based on that reply, this chain is going to repeat. And after repetition, whenever final assessment order is being drafted, when final assessment order is being drafted, then this final assessment order shall be reviewed by the review unit. This is the final step. Assessing officer might have, that means this assessment unit might have done certain mistakes, they have committed certain mistakes. In order to eliminate them also, the thing that was constituted here is finally review unit. Sir, we have four units here finally if you observe. Number one assessment unit, number two verification unit, number three technical unit, number four review unit. These four units shall verify our information. After confirmation of this review unit, final assessment order will be given by NEC, not by review unit. Sir, this assessment unit, verification unit, technical unit, review unit is nothing but staff of, they are the employees of NEC. every communication directly these four units cannot make. Every communication should be made through National E-Assessment Center only. From notice onwards up to this assessment order, everything will be communicated through NEC. That means the person who is going to make assessment is not going to do verification. For verification, a separate verification unit has been constituted. And for the purpose of obtaining knowledge, technical assistance, separate technical unit existed. And this assessment unit, if their point of view is order has been drafted in mistake, for that purpose, review unit is also constituted. A perfect control system has been constituted by CBDT here. So begin with first notice under 143.2 shall be issued by NEC. Case will be allotted to assessment unit. Assessment unit sends the information to verification unit for verification. After confirmation by verification unit, if any technical assistance is required, they take the services of technical unit and they shall pass a draft order. This draft order will be communicated to the SSE. SSE, if he files the reply, again this chain repeats. And now this order will be given to review unit, since every complete assessment has been completed. For the purpose of finalization, they shall pass it to review unit. Now what the review unit does is, they shall completely verify whether there are any mistakes in the assessment order and communicate that everything is clear. Now this order can be issued to National E-Assessment Center. Finally, National E-Assessment Center communicates to the SSE the final assessment order. And after filing such final assessment order, the next thing, you are all aware that such final assessment order, if any, just in the beginning session only I have discussed that, after filing final assessment order, yes, if there is any mistake, then we can go for rectification process. If there is any dispute, we can go for appeal process. This thing is quite natural. As we have regular assessment procedure, this thing is quite natural. The thing, a new procedure is constituted, is that between issuance of notice under 143.2 and between assessment under 143.3, for this gap, a procedure called e-assessment has been constituted. This is what the clarification I am going to give you. How this e-assessment has to be done? That is what, as of now, I have clarified you in a complete manner. First, I have discussed the structure. Next, I have specified you the procedure by way of a chart. Okay. Now, the final thing that is going to do here is, first thing begins with notice given by NEC, and final order will also be given by NEC. For giving this final order, in middle, they are going to take the help of this assessment unit, verification unit, technical unit and review unit. Okay, I think this point is very clear. The person who issues notice is only going to issue order also. Okay, now the thing to be remembered here is, who will recover this tax? What is the use of jurisdictional assessing officer then? Everyone may have doubt that then, since everything is being made online, then what is the use of assessing officer here? Then what the assessing officer is going to do now? Now let us come to that point. National E-Assessment Center shall pass the final assessment order. And after completion of the assessment, electronic record shall be transferred to the assessing officer. All this information, sir, after completing assessment, I am going to give you clarification. After that, now they are going to hand over the case to the jurisdictional assessing officer. Now, what the jurisdictional assessing officer does is imposition of penalty and recovery of the tax. Now, our assessing officer does not have any right to give any modification in the assessment order. If there is any mistake, rectification under section 154. Just now I have specified you. This process is quite natural. If there is any mistake, SSE can come for rectification. If there is any dispute, appeal or revision. This process is quite natural, as we have had it earlier only. The thing is same. Or SSE can go for appeal to CIT appeals under 246A.
Now what the assessing officer is going to do is recovery of the taxes, okay? And if SSC approaches commissioner appeals, this electronic record shall be passed by assessing officer to CIT appeals, okay? And if any prosecution proceedings shall be initiated, now this everything will be dealt by the assessing officer. That means earlier assessing officer has first notice, assessment, verification, review, passing of order, institution of penalty and prosecution proceedings. Earlier, all these aspects will be dealt by assessing officer only. But now, all these activities have been decentralized. Now, this notice shall be issued by National E-Assessment Center. Assessment shall be made by assessment unit. Verification shall be made by verification unit. And order shall be reviewed by the review unit. Finally, order shall be passed by National E-Assessment Center. Now, penalty and prosecution proceedings shall be constituted by the assessing officer. That means assessing officer work has been reduced. Everything will be taken care by these units. Now, what the assessing officer is required to do is, after passing assessment order, he has to check whether we have to impose any penalty, or whether any taxes have to be collected and recovered, or whether any rectification of mistake, or giving effect of appellate orders. These are the things which need to be checked by the assessing officer. So that means whether there are any mistakes which can be rectified under 154, or whether SC go for appeals. These are all the things to be checked by assessing officer now. Now penalty and prosecution proceedings shall only be instituted by the assessing officer. Okay. Sir, whether this e-assessment is mandatory for all the SSCs, this thing is to be noted that National E-Assessment Center may, not mandatory, may at any stage of assessment, if considers necessary, shall refer the case to the assessing officer having jurisdiction over such case. So the National E-Assessment Center may at any stage of assessment, if it considers necessary, transfer the case to the jurisdiction over the case. That means some cases, if National E-Assessment Center picks, for example, 100 cases for scrutiny, some cases, for example, 10 cases shall be transferred to jurisdictional assessing officer. Now, what this AO is required to do? All these powers, notice, assessment, verification, review, order, penalty, now everything vests with assessing officer only. If case is transferred to AO, if case is not transferred to AO, now NEC is going to take this procedure for the purpose of assessment. So I think this procedure is very clear. In every stage of assessment, the thing to be noted here is opportunity of being heard. Opportunity of being heard will completely be provided to the SSC. Based on that only they are going to levy this. Procedure for levying penalty. Sir, penalty is not mandatory, it may. If SSC do not give reply to the NEC, if notice is issued, if SSC non-compliance of any notice, direction of order, then they can constitute penalty proceedings. Penalty may be under 270A, 50% of the tax to 200% of the tax payable. Now penalty under 270A. In such cases, penalty under section 271AAB, 30% of the tax, or 60% of the, sorry, 30% based on undisclosed income. In such cases, if complete disclosure is made, then 30% shall be levied as penalty. If nothing has been disclosed, 60% shall be levied as the penalty in case of penalty under section 271AAB for such cases. And in case 271AAC, recently for section 68, 69ABC, this penalty under section 271AAC to the extent of 10% of the tax is being levied. So penalty, the section may be any section, whatever may be the section, now penalty shall also be levied if SSC in non-compliance of notice, direction of or order, penalty shall also be levied is the conclusion. That penalty may be levied either directly by the National E-Assessment Center or through a Singh officer, anything may be. If you refer here, they can send to a Singh officer to levy penalty, or here itself, National E-Assessment Center itself can call upon and shall levy upon the penalty, is the conclusion. So I think this provision is very clear. And procedure for appeal, after communication of assessment order by NEC, in such a case, appeal shall lie to CIT appeals. This is a regular procedure. That's what I have specified you here. Sir, the thing that was changed is between 143.2 and 143.3, that gap, how to make the assessment, that procedure has been converted into assessment. After passing assessment order, this mistake, dispute concept is quite simple and as per earlier process only. There is no new process for mistake and disputes. The only process that was implemented here is e-assessment scheme. That thing I have clarified you here. So now I am going to solve the queries which were raised here, and after that I will go for best judgment assessment. Sir, as of now we have discussed regarding intimation, scrutiny notice, scrutiny time limit for conclusion, and next thing we are going to have a discussion on best judgment assessment. First let me solve the queries that were raised here. After that I shall go to best judgment assessment. So coming to today's queries, the first query is regarding, sir, in case validity of notice is under dispute, whether AO can levy penalty under 271(1)(b). Okay, so the question here is, generally if scrutiny notice is issued under 143 subsection 2 and SSC failed to communicate to the notice, then penalty of 10,000 shall be levied. Sir, when this scrutiny notice has to be issued? Within 6 months from the end of the year in which return of income has been filed. Within 6 months from the end of the year in which return has been filed, this notice has to be issued under 143 subsection 2. Sir, this 6 months notice should be served in the manner by way of email. Rather than sending email, if assessing officer has sent through WhatsApp or Telegram, using these applications, if assessing officer sends notice, is it a proper communication? Answer is no. If you refer here, I have already constituted in section 282 that methods of serving notice in section 282, what I have already communicated to you is through email ID they have to constitute. If assessing officer sends notice through WhatsApp, whether it is a valid communication of notice? No. SSC need not reply to such notice also. Now everything is made through online only. So sending notices through WhatsApp, Telegram is not the correct mode of communication. If they serves, it is an invalid notice. If SSC does not reply to invalid notice, then penalty will not be levied under section 271-10,000. That penalty, if only proper manner communicated and SSC do not give reply, then only that penalty will be applicable. Okay. So I have clarified regarding the first issue. Now coming to second issue. So we have special discussion on best judgment, but before such discussion, let me solve the queries that were raised here. Sir, for assessment year 1920, there is also new date. Please discuss it. Yes, that's what I have discussed this. Up to 31st December, they have extended. Actually, by this 30th September, assessment 1920 scrutiny has to be closed. But they have extended up to 31st December. Okay. Next. Sir, e-assessment notice is uploaded on income tax portal. Okay. Which SSC is not aware, as neither physical notice received nor email received, and assessment is completed ex parte. Now, what is the recourse? Sir, this assessment is valid assessment only, because what the thing I have shown here is, if they present it in official website, it is also a proper mode of serving notice. This assessment is valid only. Now, what is the proper recourse you need to do is, you offer appeal. Rather than going for appeal, there is no other option. Okay. Next. Is limited scrutiny assessment is also in electronic form? Yes. Sir, scrutiny here, if you refer, three types of scrutiny. Number one, limited scrutiny. Number two, complete scrutiny. Number three, e-assessment. If you divide it into three categories. So here, limited scrutiny cases also, assessment year 17-18 was completed limited scrutiny cases.
now assessment year 1920 or 1819, whatever may be, for that limited scrutiny cases, now this also to be done through National E-Assessment Center only, or National E-Assessment Center shall allot the case to assessing officer. In such case only, assessing officer will deal the case. Unless the case is given to assessing officer, National E-Assessment Center itself does the assessment through assessment unit, technical unit, review unit. They have to follow this procedure only. Okay. Next, sir, does review unit means audit of assessment unit? No. Review unit is very difficult, very different. First, assessment unit will pass a draft assessment order which will be reviewed by the review unit. Both were completely different. Okay. Next, here REC do not play any role. It is simply to pass to AU only. Yes, here review unit does not have anything. A complete assessment will be done by assessment unit only. Sir, if you refer this procedure, since this is a new thing, everyone might express difficulties in implementation. But the thing to be noticed here is complete assessment will be done by this assessment unit only. So the thing that was required to do by assessing officer is to collect the taxes and levy penalties and prosecution. Rather than that, nothing right now has been specified to assessing officer. Okay. Or else entire case can be transferred to assessing officer. If you remember my discussion, at any stage in case of e-assessment, sir, one thing I am going to give you clarification is, now every word that I have discussed is in this notification. So you make a note of this notification, notification 61/2019 and notification 62/2019. Two notifications were given regarding this e-assessment procedure, 61/2019 and 62/2019. Okay, these two only. Based on these two, I have given complete clarification. These charts and this presentation is out of such notifications only. Okay, and next thing to be next question. In e-assessment procedure, at what time CIT appeals or ITAT will come into force? After passing of assessment order by NEC, within 30 days you need to approach CIT appeals. After CIT appeals, within 60 days we need to approach ITAT. So this time limit begins after passing assessment order by e-assessment, National E-Assessment Center. Okay. Next, how to know whether there is ultraviolence of jurisdiction of AO? Scope of powers defined for each unit. Sir, okay, scope of power here is, since everything is being done through National E-Assessment Center, now there is no scope of ultraviolence. Whether assessment unit has done in correct manner or not, you have to go for appeal and decide there. We do not have any direct communication with assessment unit. Every communication is through mails, is through online communication only. And video conferencing, one option has been presented, but still not yet implemented. Rather than that, if you have any further dispute, you have to go for appeal. Rather than that, there is no other option here. There is no concept of ultraviolence in case of e-assessment procedure. Everything will be done through National E-Assessment Center only. Next, sir, in case we are supposed to file 154 request, where we are supposed to file it? To jurisdiction officer only. Online, after filing, after login into income tax e-filing website. Now present procedure for 154 will get repeated for National E-Assessment proceedings also. Same rectification process. But rectification right is given to AO, but not to National E-Assessment Center. If you refer these powers, after completion of assessment, if any rectification of mistake, then it shall be done by assessing officer only. Now not by National E-Assessment Center. Next, sir, how do we know whether there is no jurisdiction in any of the units, whether any scope of powers defined for each respective unit? Yes, sir, the scope of unit, that's what I have decided in this first presentation. Each unit, sir, one thing to be noted is we have no communication with assessment unit, verification unit, technical unit or review unit. SSE do not talk to them. We have no communication with AU, assessment unit, verification unit, technical unit, review unit. We have no communication with them. We are going to communicate completely with National E-Assessment Center only. whether they are going to make ultraviolet their powers, we cannot question it. After passing assessment order, if you have any queries, you have to go for appeal. Rather than that, there is no scope for ultraviolet, because SSC do not communicate directly to assessment unit, verification unit. SSC communicates only to NEC. Okay. Next term. Sir, e-assessment completed by AO as ex parte due to non-appearance of SSC. Okay. Heavy additions are made which are deductible under 80P. Any remedy for SSC except appeal to CIT? No remedy. Except appeal, if you are not satisfied with the order passed by the assessing officer, you have two options. Number one, going for appeal to CIT appeals, or number two, application for revision under section 264 to CIT. CIT appeals is different from CIT. So you can either go for appeal or go for revision. Only these two options were available. Okay, next. Sir, would department send a draft assessment order to SSC to express objections, if any? Yes. Sir, one thing I will show you so that this point will be very easy to you. Opportunity to taxpayer. Opportunity to taxpayer. Response received from taxpayer. Opportunity to taxpayer. If you refer, 5 opportunities were given to the taxpayer in this procedure. So straight away they are not going to pass assessment order without any communication to SSC. If you refer, in 5 cases I have used the term opportunity here. That means every communication before passing final assessment order, SSC can file his objections. That is what I have specified you is draft assessment order. Initially only draft assessment order will be given to SSC. SSC can raise objections. If it is satisfactory, they shall modify the draft assessment order and pass final assessment order. If they are not satisfied with SSC's explanation, then after passing final assessment order, SSC can go for appeal. So I think this point is very clear. Everywhere the thing that was specified here is give an opportunity. Everything that was given here is give an opportunity. Everywhere opportunity of being heard will be given. It's a principle of natural justice. Okay. Next. By which date rectification latest done maximum time period? Sir, maximum time period for rectification is within 4 years from the end of the relevant assessment year. After passing assessment order, within 4 years we can apply for rectification. After application, within 6 months, AO shall rectify the order. Next, can landowner claim exemption? Okay, this is a question regarding capital gain. Let us put it later. Next. Okay, so here all the queries which were raised regarding this e-assessment procedure for scrutiny assessment has been solved now. Sir, one thing you be kept in mind is regular section 143 subsection 2 only. Instead of attendance in the office, now everything is made online. First notice will be given by National E-Assessment Center and they will allot the case to assessment unit. Assessment unit will give requirements to E-Assessment Center. They will ask the SSC. SSC will give reply to E-Assessment Center only. Now assessment unit will complete the assessment. For verification, they will take the help of verification unit. For any knowledge assistance, they will take technical assistance unit and pass draft assessment order. This draft assessment order will be communicated to SSC. SSC may again raise objections. Based on that, they will pass again draft assessment order and send back to review unit. Now review unit will finalize and send it to National E-Assessment Center. Now finally, National E-Assessment Center shall pass the assessment order. Okay, I think all these points were very clear. Still, if SSC has objections, he can go for appeal. Appeal process is same as usual. Okay. Now, let me continue my discussion. For best judgment assessment, first let me specify the circumstances of best judgment assessment so that this aspect will be very clear. So, these are the
circumstances under section 144 where best judgment assessment shall be made. Sir, up to now what the thing I have discussed to you is a scrutiny assessment. But now the thing I am going to discuss to you is a best judgment assessment. The thing to be noted here is fails. Unless SSE fails, AO cannot make best judgment assessment. Sir, you need to remember the word fail here. What the SSE has made the failure? SSE fails to furnish the return. If SSE does not file his return of income, then assessing officer is going to make assessment to his best, to his best of his judgment. So it is at his point of view he can make the assessment. And number two, SSE has failed to comply with notice under 142(1). This is practically very, very important, because now in case of demonetization scheme, who have made cash deposits in a bank account, assessing officer have issued a notice under section 142 subsection 1. Okay, that 142 subsection 1 notice, many of the SSEs have not given reply to such notice, and the consequences officer made section 144. All the bank deposits were treated as unexplained deposits. Section 69 has been executed, and unexplained money, 60% tax, surcharge, education cess, in total comes to around 78%, plus penalty under section 271 AAC to the extent of 10% of the tax have been levied. So the thing to be remembered is, whenever notice is given, SSE has to give reply. If SSE does not reply, if SSE fails to give reply, then the thing they are going to do here is automatically, the thing they are going to do is best judgment assessment. That means assessing officer discretion to complete the assessment. How to make the assessment is at officer's discretion only. Okay. Next, fails to comply with note direction under 142(2A). Department Commissioner of Income Tax shall allot some cases to chartered accountant for the purpose of assessment. Direction to get audited under 142(2A). There is a section. Now SSE has to go to such chartered accountant and complete the audit. This is not tax audit. This is separate. At the time of scrutiny, if assessing officer is unable to make the assessment, he shall refer the case to a chartered accountant nominated in the panel of commissioner. So in such a case, now everything shall be dealt by such auditor and give his report to the assessing officer. Based on that report, assessing officer shall complete the assessment. But if SSE does not get his accounts audited, even though they have made instruction, then they are going to make best judgment assessment. And SSE fails to comply with notice under 143(2), that means scrutiny notice has been issued, but SSE has failed to comply with such notice, scrutiny notice, SSE has not given reply. In these four cases, assessment shall be made under section 144 with the information available with the assessing officer. If bank statement is available, every credit shall be treated as income of the SSE, not the turnover, income of the SSE, and special tax shall be levied. So rather than going into such aspect, the thing to be remembered is SSE, if he fails to file the return, fails to give response, then only this best judgment assessment will get constituted. And next thing is circumstances in 145 subsection 3, correctness and completeness, the things which were produced by SSE, if assessing officer is not satisfied with correctness and completeness of the accounts of the SSE, or method of accounting is not regularly been followed, cash system or mercantile system regularly must be followed, but it was not followed by the SSE regularly, or accounting standards notified, that means recently ICDS has been notified, 10 ICDS, if it has not been followed by the SSE. In these cases, what the assessing officer is going to do is make best judgment assessment under section 144. What we have now discussed is circumstances. But before institution of such best judgment assessment, one opportunity will be given. In every assessment, opportunity of being heard is the criteria. So the SSE will be given an opportunity of being heard by means of a show cause notice why the assessment should not be completed to the best of the judgment of the assessing officer. So the first thing that was specified here is
an opportunity will be given to the SSE. They will issue notice before making this best judgment. We have already issued you notice under section 143 subsection 2. Still you have not complied with the notice. Why we should not make your assessment to the best of my judgment? Like this, a sitting officer is going to issue notice. Based on that, opportunity need not be given where notice under 142(1) is given. Where notice is issued under 142(1) for non-filing of return, further communication is not required. Automatically, they can do best judgment assessment without communicating to the SSE. If SSE does not give reply to this 142(1), they can directly do best judgment assessment. But practically, in this case also, again they are giving opportunity. Before passing best judgment assessment order, even for 142(1) cases also, practically they are going to give again opportunity of being heard. But actually, this 142(1) itself is an opportunity of being heard. If SSE does not communicate, they can make best judgment assessment. Okay. Next, the thing that was presented next is assessment. How the best judgment assessment shall be made? Taking into account all the materials gathered. Assessing officer shall make the assessment of the total income to the best of his judgment. On the basis of such judgment, he shall determine the sum payable by the SSE is the conclusion. So I think this point of assessment is very clear. And next thing coming into here is time limit for passing the assessment order. Sir, same as scrutiny assessment. For assessment year 18-19, 18 months. Assessment 19-20, 12 months. So 12 months has been specified as the time limit for passing assessment order. For this assessment 18-19 order, actually the due date is this one. But due to COVID-19 situation, the due date has been, 2020, okay. So due to COVID-19 situation, this has been extended to 31st December 2020. So extensions may be a different thing, but actual due date is 18 months for assessment 18-19. For assessment 19-20, 12 months is the actual thing. And wherever transfer pricing, arm's length price provisions attracts, an additional time limit of 12 months is much more available. Okay. And now coming into our discussion, other points. The opportunity given must be real and effective. Generally, if you go for appeal, opportunity is not real. This is the term we are going to use. So the thing that was specified here is the opportunity given by officer must be real and effective. The notice must be given, communicated, and explanation from SC has to be obtained. Unless this was obtained, this is not treated as an opportunity. Unless opportunity is given, they cannot make best judgment assessment. First, they have to communicate that why I should not make your assessment as best judgment, because you are failure to file the return under 142(1). Like that, the opportunity given must be real and effective is the conclusion. And where assessment is being, SSE has given approximate figures in written off income. In written off income, SSE has shown that sales 1.6 crores exactly. Purchase 1 crore 40 lakhs exactly. That means SSE himself has shown approximate figures. That means this is like projections, but not audited financial statements. If SSE himself has shown approximate figures in the written off income, then assessing officer can make best judgment assessment. Okay. And this assessment must be honest and fair estimate. Let me present you one of the case. In one case, it's a manufacturing unit where books of accounts were not been maintained at all. Complete set of books were not been maintained. And that case was selected for scrutiny. And they have not submitted any requirements. Now, how the assessing officer is going to make best judgment assessment? What assessing officer has done here is just obtained the electricity bill of such manufacturing unit. What assessing officer has done is he has obtained electricity bill of such manufacturing unit. That electricity bill, he has estimated how many units can be manufactured based on such electricity consumption. For example, if 2 lakhs is the electricity bill of March month, for 2 lakhs current bill, how many hours machines would have worked? On that, for example, 8 hours per day machine would have worked. If machines were worked for 8 hours per day, how many products would have been manufactured? 100 products can be manufactured per day if 8 hours is in working. That means 100 units per day, 3000 units per month, 36000 units per annum. That means you have manufactured 36000 units in this year. 36000 units into you are selling the product for 10000. So your turnover is 3.6 crores. Turnover 3.6 crores into we are offering a presumptive income of 8%. Even though presumptive income 44AD is not applicable, a Singh officer is going to fair estimate that profit would be 8%. And he is going to issue best judgment assessment order. That means just based on one electricity bill, what the Singh officer has taken is just electricity bill of the manufacturing unit. He has assumed how many hours the machines work. Based on that, how many units he have produced. Based on that, how much will be his turnover and how much will be his profit percentage. Like that, he has made an estimate and made best judgment assessment. That means why I have given you this example is this has to be honest and fair estimate. Honest and fair estimate is the conclusion. Okay. So I think this provision is very clear. The best judgment assessment order time limits were also as usual. The normal assessment order time limits were only been given here. Okay. So one more thing I would like to present. After that, I will go for queries. First, here I have presented you the difference between notice under section 143, 142 subsection 1 and 143 subsection 2. Both were quite different from each other. Now the concept of National E-Assessment Center is applicable for 143.2 but not for 142 subsection 1. In order to clarify that point only, I have given you the differences between 142 subsection 1 and 143 subsection 2. This is a notice to file the return, but this notice will be issued to make assessment. SSC would have already filed the return and hence this notice under 143.2 will be given. This is not an assessment, but this is an assessment. Here there is no time limit for giving 142.1. After due date of filing return, after the due date of filing return of income, if still SSC have not filed return, at any time 142.1 can be issued. But this has to be issued within 6 months from the end of the finance year in which return has been filed. This is the difference. Here approval of joint commission is required if they require the balance sheet, all the assets and liability details if they required from the SSC. Approval of JC is required by the assessing officer, but here no such approval is required. Here books of account, last 3 years any books of account can be asked, but here the year in which scrutiny has been selected, such requirement shall be asked. This notice shall be issued even return is not filed, but this notice will be issued 143.2 only if the return is filed. There is a difference between 142 subsection 1 notice and 143 subsection 2 notice. And now the concept of e-assessment is applicable for notice which was issued under section 143 subsection 2 only. Okay. So I think by this, the queries, now balance queries which were raised here, let me solve it. And after that, I shall enter for other discussions. Sir, what is your view regarding high pitch assessments made by assessing officer for demonetization period? We are providing proper information, then also additions are made and demand notices are issued. Okay sir, even to my clients also the same thing has been happened. Even though we are offering complete explanation to the assessing officer, assessing officer is not going to consider it, and based on their higher authorities instructions they are going to pass the assessment order. Even though we are confirming it as turnover of the SSE in demonetization period, but assessing officer is not going to accept that it as a turnover. They are going to consider it as the income of the SSE and opting higher tax rate under section 115. If you refer, their higher tax rate has been adopted under 115 BBE. So it is very high tax rate that was adopted. Then what to do now? Rather than going for appeal, there is no other option. As you have asked, what is your view? Sir, it's not depend upon my view. The ultimately who is going to suffer here is SSC. The thing we are going to do here is go for appeals. if appellate authority does not even assessing not only assessing officer if appellate authority also does not accept our opinion then what the thing we are going to do is go for next thing ITAT their ITAT if cannot accept our opinion go for high court next supreme court this is the last thing so we have to fight it rather than that there is no other option okay next what is the difference between ex parte assessment and best judgment assessment okay sir what is the meaning of the term ex parte assessment generally if SSE does not attend to the notice given by the assessing officer then order shall be passed ex parte that means on favor of other party that means on favor of department such ex parte assessment shall be done based on section 144 I think this concept is clear ex parte assessment shall be done based on the information available with the SSE assessing officer which is nothing but best judgment assessment so both were in continuation they are going to make ex parte assessment with the facts available with the assessing officer it is nothing but best judgment assessment only okay so and next here there are three queries regarding certain other aspects let me conclude this and then I will conclude the session also okay sir can landlord claim exemption under 54F against long term capital gain on multiple flats allotted by builder without depositing any amount in capital gain account scheme sir 54F is available for one residential house if you have already one residential house you can claim for one more residential house under 54F that means maximum for two houses you can claim it as benefit so rather than that for complete flats constructed you cannot claim exemption under section 54F okay and next coming to other question if non resident is liable to file return of income if he incurred foreign travel expenses more than 2 lakhs ticket booked from Indian agent okay so this is a question regarding filing return of income sir whether return of income must be filed here is if there exist taxable incomes in India then you have to file if there is no taxable income exist in India then it need not be filed that limit might not that that limit of 2 lakhs has been constituted based on residents of India but not based on the non residents okay next any capital gain attracts to original owner GPA holder in case the person who acquired the land by way of sale in GPA wants to transfer the land in the name of children by way of gift sir one thing to be noted is gift is not liable to capital gain at all as we have discussed in capital gains that when any transaction has been given by way of gift it is not a transfer under section 47 so even GPA holders also if they transfer by way of gift capital gain does not arise okay sir if a religious trust accept donation of 5 lakhs in cash whether 269 ST will be applicable sir 269 ST there are certain exceptions for all the cases for example amount deposited in hundi 5 lakhs a person has deposited in hundi there is no proper communication that this person has contributed in cash hence 269 ST cannot be attracted against the temple for every transaction has to be considered there are certain exceptions in 269 ST they will be covered in such exception okay next so here is the last thing to be done here sir what about the revision if appeal is not made have already presented you in beginning of my discussion regarding revision if any dispute arises after passing of assessment order now SSE has two options either to go for appeal or to go for revision within 30 days you have to apply for appeal if such time period has been completed you have to go for condonation of delay if such condonation of delay is also not available they are not accepting then you can come for revision within 1 year this revision the drawback is the thing that was specified by this CIT is final and conclusive again you cannot go for appeal this is only the main drawback in revision rather than that everything will be comfortable in revision also they will also accept the explanations given by SSE But if they object, SSC cannot go for appeal. For that sake only, everyone prefers CAT appeals rather than revision. Okay. Next. Sir, one of my client was regular in GST. Okay, this is a question regarding GST. Okay. And the other thing that was asked here is, in case of closing stock, reversing ITC is required. Okay, it was required. Since today we are going to focus completely on income tax, so let us focus on that questions only. Next, sir, does issuance of show cause notice by AO necessary mean that he will levy penalty and loses his discretion to levy penalty? Okay, regarding penalty, I will show you one term now. Regarding penalty, if you see here, may, procedure for levying penalty, it has been clearly specified that may, it is not mandatory to compulsory levy the penalty. Based on explanation received from the SSC, it is at the discretion of the officer only. It may be a national e-assessment center, it may be a SSC officer, it is at their discretion but not mandatory. Okay, next. In which assessment can AO make addition to income of the SSC? In which assessment can AO make addition to the income of SSC? Any assessment, sir. Today I have presented you the overview of assessment procedure. It may be a scrutiny assessment under 143.3, income escaping assessment under 147, stretch assessment under 153A, whatever may be, addition can be made to the income of the SSC and penalty shall be levied. So, on certain assessment, addition cannot be made. There is no such exceptions. On any type of assessment, addition can be made to the income of the SSC. Okay. Next, GST revision classes. Okay, sir, it's already available in the portal. So, you can go to the playlist. So, you can go through it. Okay. So, all the things, all the queries that were raised here have been solved. So, the thing to be noticed today, sir, let me conclude in an easy manner. E-assessment procedure is the next trending topic. How to communicate everything through online. So now there is no manual representations, no dealings. Everything will be through online. If the communication is acceptable, SC will be the safe. If it is not acceptable, SSC should have to go for appeal. But in every way, everywhere, opportunity of being heard will be provided to the SSC. Okay. So I think today's discussion is very clear. And tomorrow, very, very important aspects we are going to discuss. 147 income escaping assessment and 153A stretch assessment order. These two things we are going to discuss in tomorrow's session. And today, the last query that was raised here is, if loss is reduced in assessment, can penalty is imposed? Yes, penalty under 270A, if you remember, not only for addition of income, loss is reduced from 10 lakhs to 5 lakhs. That difference 5 lakhs is nothing but addition of income. Their tax will not be levied, but penalty under section 270A will be levied. On such 5 lakhs, generally how much tax arises, they will calculate. But this tax need not be paid. But on this tax amount, 50% in normal cases, 200% in fraud cases, penalty should be levied. So even the loss decreases, penalty will be levied. Not only in increase of income, decrease of loss means nothing but increase of income. Penalty will be levied even in decrease of losses also. Okay. So by this we have completed our discussion. Tomorrow we shall have a discussion on income escaping and stretch assessment cases. So thank you. Thank you very much.